grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
And good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
On this first night of our parish mission, we pause to ask ourselves, what does it mean to sign ourselves in the name of the Father? So as we begin our celebration tonight, let's just once again pause and call to mind the fact that our God, ours is a God of mercy. Ours is a God of love and compassion. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God continue to have mercy on us. May God forgive us all our sins. And may God bring each and every one of us to everlasting life.
Amen.
As you came in tonight, you were given the parish mission prayer. And together let us pray.
I accept the sign of the cross on my forehead to learn to know and love Jesus.
On my ears that I may hear the voice of the Lord. On my eyes that I may see the glory of God. On my lips that I may respond to the word of the Lord. On my heart that Christ may dwell there by faith. On my shoulders that I may bear the gentle yoke of Christ. On my hands, that Christ may be known in my work. On my feet, that I may walk in the way of Christ. I accept the sign of the cross as the promise of eternal life, if I am faithful to my vocation as a Christian. Amen.
Please be seated for the first reading.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption, through which we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if only we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
There was a scholar of the law who stood up to test Jesus. He asked, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" The lawyer said in reply, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your strength and with all your being, and your neighbor as yourself." Jesus replied, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live forever." But because the lawyer wished to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man fell victim to robbers as he went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. They stripped and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down that road, and when he saw the man in the ditch, he passed by on the opposite side. Likewise, a Levite came to that place, and when he saw the man in the ditch, he too passed by on the opposite side. But then, a Samaritan traveler came upon him, and he was moved with compassion at the sight. He approached the victim, poured oil and wine over his wounds, and bandaged them. Then he lifted him up on his own animal, took him to an inn, and cared for him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins. And gave them to the innkeeper with the instruction, 'Take care of him. If you spend more than what I have given you, I will repay you on my way back.' Now, which of these 3, Jesus asked, in your opinion, was neighbor to the robber's victim?" The lawyer replied, "The man who treated him with mercy." Jesus said to the lawyer, "Well, then go and do the same." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We don't know when it first happened. As a child, an adolescent, some scripture scholars tell us it might have first happened at his baptism. But the fact is, we really don't know when it first happened. But at some point in his life, Jesus looked up into the sky and addressing the God whom he had been taught was far, far away. Addressing the God whom he had been taught, his name would never be found on human lips. Jesus looked up into the sky and he called this God by the same name he used to call Saint Joseph. Abba. Father. And that caused an earthquake in the teachings of traditional Judaism. You know, the English translation, father, really stumbles in bearing the emotional weight of the Aramaic word, Abba. Because Abba is a term of deep, deep intimacy, affection, and familiarity. And it was this insight that God was an Abba to be loved, and not some distant, far away God. It was this insight that caused Jesus to do what Jesus did. This idea that God was Abba motivated Jesus. It was the fire burning in his belly, and it catapulted him into ministry. As scholars tell us, you will never understand why Jesus would eat with prostitutes. You will never understand why Jesus ate with public sinners, unless you know that for Jesus, God is Abba. And as some people suggest, it was this insight that God was Father that drove the first nail on Good Friday. Because it was that scandalous to holy, pious Jews. I'm 57 years old, and I've spent the vast majority of my adult life studying and writing about adult spirituality. And I've come to discover one thing. The way you think about God, your image of God, the way you think about God is probably the most important aspect of your spiritual life. Because your image of God, the way you think about God, shapes and colors everything that you do. From how you understand suffering to the reason why you pray. And that's why I always like to tell people, it is utterly important that your image of God, the way you think about God, is healthy and Christian. Because an unhealthy image of God will lead to unhealthy behavior. Let me give you a perfect example. Her name was Gertrude. She died at the age of 82. I didn't know her, but I knew her best friend. And from her best friend, I had learned that Gertrude spent more than 60 years, more than half her life. Gertrude spent more than 60 years living in fear of God and living in fear of death. And the reason why she feared God and she feared death was because as a teenager, she had committed a sin that she thought God would never forgive her of. And so she spent more than 60 years living in fear of God, living in fear of dying. Well, guess what? At the age of 82, the inevitable happened. She died. And even though I didn't know her, but because I knew her best friend, I decided to go to the wake service. Walking to the funeral home, to the open coffin, and I go up to the coffin, and I'm looking at the corpse of 82-year-old Gertrude. And I'm saying a prayer for her. And I'm asking God, to grant her the eternal rest and the eternal peace that she obviously did not experience here on earth. Well, as I'm standing in front of the coffin praying for her, a woman comes up to me. Now, this woman thinks that I know, that I knew 82-year-old Gertrude. And this woman said something that I thought was very, very insightful. This woman says to me, "You know, Father, Gertie would have been a different person if only she had had a different God. But the God she believed in was hard as nails and carried a big stick." How true. Gertie would have been a different person if only she had had a different God. But the God she believed and the way she thought about God was that God was hard as nails and God carried a big stick. Now let me ask you something. What about you? Does your image of God bring out the best in you? Does your image of God inspire you to heroic virtue, to generous acts of love, and merciful compassion and forgiveness? Because let me tell you something. In the end, that's what holiness is all about. It's all about love, compassion, forgiveness. It's so much more than simply going to daily mass and saying a couple of prayers. Holiness is all about heroic virtue. It's about dying to myself so that the lives of other people can be improved. Does my image of God, the way I think about God, does my image of God inspire me? Does it light a fire in my belly to make me die to myself and that I live a life of heroic virtue? Does my image of God challenge me to delve into the lives of other people? I came back from mainland China in 2004. And after I had come back, my provincial, my religious superior, asked me if I would go and teach theology in our small Franciscan university in Quincy, Illinois. A couple of months ago, I was preaching in Laramie, Wyoming. Lady came up to me one night after the mission. She says, "Now, Father," she says, "I thought I knew all about Illinois, but Quincy? Where exactly is Quincy?" I looked at her and I said, "Lady, you want me to tell you where Quincy is? Get in your car, start driving, and just when you think you're lost, you ain't lost. You're in Quincy, Illinois." Quincy is located at the very southern tip of the state of Illinois. And it's because of where it's positioned, if you want to go to a big bookstore, you got to make a choice. You either drive 2 hours due east to the state capital of Springfield, or you travel 2 hours due south to St. Louis, Missouri. Once a month, while I was stuck in Quincy, once a month I get in my car and I go down to St. Louis to a Barnes & Noble. Now, let me tell you how you get to St. Louis from Quincy. You get on the interstate, and you're only on the interstate for like 6 minutes. Because then when you get to Hannibal, Missouri, you know, Hannibal, Mark Twain thing? In Hannibal, Missouri, you get off the interstate, and you have to make a hard left on Route 61. But now be careful, because the minute you make that hard left on 61, the speed limit reduces to 30 miles an hour. And there is this crummy state trooper who hides in a blind spot just waiting to give you a ticket. His name is Julian. I got to be on first name basis, but he gave me three tickets. But you know what? Sadly, that's how so many people think about God. We think of God as State Officer Julian, waiting to give a speed, to give us a speed ticket. And you know what? As I mentioned in my homily yesterday, you can never love a God like that. Most you can give a God like that is your respect. And yet Jesus challenges us to love God with all our hearts, all our souls, all our minds, and all our strength. He died in June of 1999. And unfortunately, most Catholics here in America never heard his name before. But let me tell you something. You go anywhere else in the English-speaking Roman Catholic world. You go to Ireland, you go to England, you go to Scotland, go to New Zealand, go to Australia, and mention the name Cardinal Basil Hume, and people's eyes just light up. Cardinal Hume was a man of extraordinary holiness. I had the rare opportunity many, many years ago to hear Cardinal Hume give a talk in Denver, Colorado. And I heard this story straight from the horse's mouth. Cardinal Hume told us that as a child growing up in England, his mother wanted to teach him self-discipline. So, at the beginning of Lent, Ash Wednesday, every year, she would bake his favorite cookie. And she would put those cookies in a cookie jar. And she would place that cookie jar right on the center of the kitchen table. And then she would call young Basil into the kitchen. And she would say to him, now unfortunately, I can't do a British accent, so I'm going to pretend like Mrs. Hume came from New Orleans. So his mother would look at him, and she would say, now, sugar pop, let me tell you something. I have just finished baking your favorite cookie, and they are right here in this cookie jar. But don't you dare. Don't you dare sneak in here and eat one of them, because remember, it's Lent, and God is watching you. Cardinal Hume told us, for years, he lived in fear of the policeman of the cookie jar. And it was years later, after he had become a Benedictine monk, after he was ordained a priest, after he had been made a bishop, and after he had become a cardinal in the church, one night, he's praying before the Blessed Sacrament, and it suddenly dawned on him. Had he snuck into that kitchen? And had he reached his hand into that cookie jar? allow one of those cookies just to touch his lips? Yes, indeed. The clouds would have parted. The sky would have rent open. And God the Father, sitting on the throne of judgment, would have looked down at him, and God would have said, Basil Hume, they're so good, have another one. That's the Abba of Jesus. He's not the policeman of the cookie jar. God is the God of the chocolate chip cookie. And every time you and I make the sign of the cross and we say in the name of the Father, we're calling to mind the fact that our God is a God of love, of mercy, of compassion, and forgiveness. Any other image of God is not Christian. And it's not healthy. You know, so even though Jesus calls God Abba, Father, in the Gospels we clearly see Jesus had a profound appreciation for the feminine side of God. This is what I find fascinating. Even though Jesus was born and raised in a male-dominated culture, Jesus had an appreciation for the feminine side of God. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, when he talks about God's forgiveness, what does Jesus compare God to? To a woman. To a woman who wakes up late at night and sweeps her house looking for a lost coin. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, Jesus says that our God feeds the birds and he makes the wild flowers grow. Well, if you know anything about Jewish culture in Jesus' time, it was the woman of the house who took care of the family pets. It was the woman of the house who watered the garden. See, even though Jesus called God Abba Father, that doesn't say everything there is to say about God. Because there is a tender, maternal side to God. And I suspect that's why Pope John Paul I, on September 10th, 1978, John Paul I said in the Wednesday audience, God is Father, but God is also Mother. You see, God possesses both the masculine and the feminine. The best of the man, the best of the woman. And we call that to mind every time we sign ourselves in the name of the Father. The old teacher of wisdom called his two disciples to himself. And he asked them, my son, tell me, how do you know that the night is over and the day has dawned? And one disciple right away said, oh, Master, you know that the night is over and the day has dawned when from far, far away you see a tree and you can tell whether it's an apple tree or a pear tree, then you know the night is over, the day is dawned. And the old teacher of wisdom shook his head and said, no. So then the other disciple said, oh, Master, you know that the night is over, and the day has truly dawned, when from far, far away you see an animal, and you can tell whether it's a dog or a sheep. Then you know the night is over, the day is dawn. The old teacher of wisdom shook his head and said, no. So then the two disciples protested. Well, tell us, Master, when is the night over? When has the day dawned? And the old teacher of wisdom looked at his two disciples and said, my brothers, you know that the night is really over and the day has truly dawned in your heart when you can look into the eyes of another human being and see there your brother or your sister. Until then, your soul is steeped in the darkness of midnight. Friends, it is the great illumination in the spiritual life that we are brothers and sisters to one another. We are family. If God is Abba Father, then that means we are related. That means we are brothers and sisters, despite the different color of our skin, despite the different ethnic backgrounds we have, we're family. This is not rocket science. This is exactly the point that Jesus was trying to make tonight in the parable of the Good Samaritan. Listen, with all due respect, shame on us. Shame on us. How often have you and I done exactly what the priest and the Levite, the deacon, what the priest and the Levite did in the parable? How often have we deliberately ignored the poor? We have deliberately crossed the street in order to avoid it. And yet, Jesus says it's the foreigner, the Samaritan. In Jesus' day, Samaritans weren't even considered Jews. It's the Samaritan who does what is right. And that's why Jesus ends the gospel parable by saying, now you go and you do the same. Listen, in a world, and I am embarrassed to admit it, in a church that deliberately leaves people behind in the ditch because of discrimination, because of prejudice, because of apathy, because of bigotry, because of intolerance, because of narrow-mindedness, the sign of the cross is a counter-cultural action. And it proclaims that we are all brothers and sisters to one another. We are all family. And it is God's will that no one be left behind in the ditch. And it's for that reason that Jesus challenges us. Now you go and you do the same. I find it fascinating that Jesus tells this parable in order to explain the great commandment. You should love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. In explaining who my neighbor is, Jesus shows us in the parable not only how to love God, he shows us where God is found. Our God is found in the ditch, among the poor, among the marginalized, among the forgotten, and among those in need, among the immigrants, among the aliens, and among the migrants. Are you aware of that? Are your eyes open? Or is your soul still steeped in the darkness of midnight? My last name, Haase, it's Russian. My grandfather came from St. Petersburg in Russia. And I can remember Grandpa Haase used to always love to tell the story about Yuri Gagarin. Yuri Gagarin was the first Russian cosmonaut and the first person to orbit the Earth in 1961. And after Gagarin came back from his historic space flight, the Russian government used to like to trot him out as the poster boy to talk about the superiority of the Russian space program and the truth of atheism. According to Grandpa Haase, one day, Yuri Gagarin was giving his talk about his space flight in Moscow. And he says to the audience, "Comrades, I have circled far above the heavens, and I have discovered there is no God in heaven." Story goes, a Russian Orthodox priest immediately stood up, interrupted him, and said, "Comrade Gagarin, you will never find God in heaven unless you first find God here on earth." You and I will never find God in heaven unless we start finding him here on earth. Are your eyes open? Has the day dawned within your soul? Because let me tell you something. This is the test of holiness. And you either pass it or you flunk it. And I'm here to tell you, on Good Friday, 1981, my life changed because I flunked the test. It was Good Friday afternoon, 1981, and I found myself in Herman's Sporting Goods store in downtown Chicago. I was buying a pair of running shoes. I looked at my watch, and I saw it was getting near 3 o'clock, the time when the Good Friday service was going to begin at Holy Name Cathedral. So I very quickly bought my shoes and very quickly stepped up my pace because I was determined I got to get to church on time. I walked out of Herman's Sporting Goods store and I'm narrow-minded. I'm going to the cathedral to be there at 3 o'clock. And a beggar on the street comes up to me and says, "Sir, can you give me a quarter? I haven't eaten all day." Now listen, I could tell by the alcohol on his breath. He wasn't being honest with me. And so like what we always do, like everybody does, I ignored him. I pretended like I didn't hear him. And I stepped up my pace, and I kept on walking. I must have walked about 30 yards or so. And to this day, I don't know if I heard it here, if I heard it here. I don't know. But I do remember, all of a sudden, something said to me, "Albert, turn around. Turn around." So I turned around. And there was Jesus where the beggar had been. And on Good Friday afternoon, 1981, Jesus looked at me in the eye and he said, "Albert, not even a quarter? Not even today? Good Friday?" On Good Friday, 1981, I flunked the test. If you don't find God here on earth, I'm telling you, you ain't gonna find him in heaven. Listen, to ignore Christ in the tabernacle is a blasphemy. To ignore Christ in my neighbor is a sacrilege. That's why the Christian scriptures are always eager, trying to tell us how Jesus constantly comes among us, and we never recognize him. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25. Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or naked or prison? Whenever you did not do it to the least of my brothers and my sisters, you did not do it to me. On Easter morning, Mary goes racing to the tomb. She thinks he's the gardener. And Jesus, somewhat perturbed, looks at her and says, Mary? And then suddenly, her eyes were open. The two disciples on the road to Emmaus. Jesus is walking with them, explaining the scriptures to them. And they don't even recognize him. The story, the fantastic story of the conversion of the great preacher, Saul. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, sir? I am Jesus, whom you persecute in my followers. You know, when you say it in a southern accent, it rhymes. Our God is a God of surprise and disguise. Never forget it. He's a God of surprise and disguise. 2 years ago, I was preaching a parish mission in Lakewood, New Jersey. Lakewood, New Jersey is famous for one thing and one thing alone. It has the largest population of Hasidic Jews outside the state of Israel. The Hasidic Jews are the real traditional Jews. They wear the long black coats and the big black hats, and they got the earlocks. The Hasidic Jews have a wonderful world. They believe that every day God sends 100 angels into our lives. Every day, you and I have 100 visits from God. Now, if you believe that, what happened to the Blessed Mother at the Annunciation? When Gabriel entered her life and asked her to be the mother of Jesus, that ain't nothing. I get 100 of those a day. But the difference between the Blessed Mother and Albert Haase, the Blessed Mother's eyes were wide open. She was wide awake. The sun had dawned within her heart, and she could recognize this visitor as an angel from God. My brothers and sisters, to sign ourselves in the name of the Father is to turn the values of this world upside down and topsy-turvy. It's to call to mind the fact that the God we believe in is not to be feared. Our God is to be loved. Ours is the God of the chocolate chip cookie. He's not the policeman of the cookie jar. And if I have a healthy image of God, and if I have a Christian image of God, then I'm also reminded every time I make the sign of the cross that not only is God Father, but also you and I are family, because we have the same Father. You and I are brothers and sisters to one another. And if the sun has really dawned within my heart, and if my eyes are really open, then I will recognize every day I am visited by God 100 times. And then, when we die, we will certainly find and recognize God in heaven. You know why? Because we will have seen him and gotten to know him time and time again. Right here on earth. And so we conclude the first night of our parish mission by not only professing who our God is, but also who we are to one another. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
amen.
May the Lord give you his peace. Yeah. Actually, you applauded too soon, because here's the bad news. I charge an exorbitant amount for my parish mission. So to help defray the cost of the mission, each night, beginning tonight, we're going to take up a collection to help to defray the cost that your parish has taken on by having me here.